Hey folks, this is Cindy. Thanks so much for stopping by. I am back with another video for Spellbinders, and I am going to be using the Bird on Cherry Branch die set today, and I'm going to show you how to Copic color it. Now, Copic coloring die cuts can be kind of intimidating sometimes depending on what die cut you are coloring in, but I really find them really enjoyable. I really like to take something that isn't necessarily intended and turn it into something completely different. So that's what we're going to be doing today. Now, I have some Nina Solar White cardstock that I had die cut with the Bird on Cherry Branch die, and I have it on top of another piece of paper, and sometimes that's really important when you're Copic coloring because it really stops all of that ink from spreading out and bleeding where you don't want it to. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm taking a really good look at my die cut here, and I'm picking out the first image that makes sense to me, and that would be those cherries. I can also see those leaves really well, but I'm going to focus on the cherries first. And only really because that's kind of the first thing that jumped out to me, so it makes sense that I would start on them first. Now I'm starting with my favorite red color family, that's R22, R24, R27, and R39. You certainly do not need to use four colors on these tiny little cherries. It's just something that I do. I would, however, not skip that R39. You're definitely going to need that deeper, darker color to help add some of that shadow, and that's really what's going to help separate some of these images. So at the moment when I'm doing is I am just mapping this out with my lightest color. This is my R22, and I'm separating those cherries because they're die cut all in one piece, but I want to make them look like they're separate images. So I'm starting with my lightest, so that way if I make a mistake, it's not a big deal. It's going to get covered up anyway. And then I'll go in with my darkest color. Now I do end up speeding this up because this video is long enough as it is, but I wanted you to see how all of these come to life, so I wanted to make sure I got it all in there, so I have them sped up quite a bit. And I'm not really doing anything fancy in terms of coloring. There's no real technique here. I am just doing some pretty lazy C shapes. Now I am trying to pay attention where my shadows and my highlights are going, because I don't want them to look like one big blob. Like, the whole point of this is to make them look like they're separate images. So I might draw a C shape in one direction on one cherry, and then I'll alternate it on another so the light source hits it in a different spot, so the shadow hits it in a different spot. So once all of these are colored in, you're going to be able to tell the difference between them. After the R39, I went in with that R27, and now I'm at the R24. If you were to do this with three colors, I would definitely do the R22, R24, and R39 and skip that R27. For me, I like how it blends out just a wee bit better with that R27, but these are small enough images you honestly wouldn't notice it. After I was done with that R24, I went in with the R22 and gave it a good coating with that, but then I felt like I needed to make these just a tiny bit darker, so I'm coming back in with the R24. I will finish that off really well one more time with the R22, and then I'm going to call it a day. The next thing I'm going to work on are those leaves, because those are the other images that really stand out to me. And that's going to be my whole approach to this whole thing, is I'm going to work on each image that I work on is going to be the next thing that starts to stand out in my mind. And the more I work on this, the more I'm going to be able to make sense of the entire die cut. So this is my favorite G family. This is the G12, G14, G17, and G29. And this is just like the reds. You don't need to use four different colors, but if you're going to skip one, I would definitely skip the G17 and keep that G29. Again, it's those shadow colors that really make a difference. I'm also going to show you how I do all of these, because I want you to be able to see how these, again, start to take shape. So if you decide to do this on your own, you'll have a little bit of a direction to go in. And it's really not that hard, folks. It's just a little time and consuming, because you really need to take the time and take a look at your die cut and how these images should look. Also, don't be afraid to take a little bit of creative license. If you think that a leaf goes there, then by all means, put in a leaf. It's not a big deal. Now I'm bringing in the G29. This is my darkest shadow color. This one is important, so I want to make sure that I get this in there. I need that shadow. And I'm also focusing on where that shadow would go in particular. So if it's underneath a cherry, I'm going to draw just a tiny little line there underneath that cherry so you can see the difference between the leaf and the cherry. Same with that leaf that's right up there underneath the breast of that bird. I wanted to make sure that you could see a difference there, so I made sure I just drew a tiny, tiny little line. And that's all I'm really doing with these. Again, there isn't a specific technique that I'm following. I'm just getting the lines down. In some cases, I draw like three little dashes on the leaf and I call it good. This is the G17. I always feel like that G17 helps things blend out a little bit better in this particular green combination. But again, you could skip it. These are so small, you probably wouldn't even notice. And then the next color I'm going to bring in is the G14. I really love this green. It is my favorite green out of all of the green Copics. It's called Apple Green. It is really nice and bright. It helps things pop quite a bit. And it looks amazing with this red color family. Now, when I started this, I knew that I was going to be adding some die-cut flowers to this to add some more dimension to this. But I wasn't quite certain where I was going to put them, so I decided to color in all of these leaves. Now, if you had a plan, you could definitely skip all of them, but since I wasn't sure, I wanted to be more safe than sorry. And as I said, I want to make sure that I don't have any white showing on my card once I start adhering all of this to my card, because I know that I'm going to be doing some ink blending on the background, and I know that it's going to be just dark enough that if there's any white showing, you're really going to see it. So now I'm going to start working on this branch, and this branch is super duper easy. I could have even made it easier yet, but I can't help myself. So I'm using four different browns. I have E31, E23, E25, and E29. Again, I'm really focused on adding this dimension to this die cut, even though that these images are super duper small. So I decided to go with all four of them. You don't need to do that. However, hang on to that E29. It is your shadow color and you will need it a little bit. For now, I'm just adding a good covering of the E31. Now I use E31 in replacement of the E21 because my E21 is out of ink. But if you have an E21, definitely use that. It will still look fabulous because that is actually the color that's meant to be used with this brown color family. So I'm just going in and I'm making sure everything is covered up. As you can see, I've kind of slowed down a little bit. In fact, right here, I pause because I am taking a look at the overall die. I am getting closer to that bird, and I want to make sure that I leave his tail uncolored. Now, if I accidentally do color over it with the browns, it's not a big deal because I'm going to be coloring him the top half of him blue, and I'd be able to cover that up. But it's always good to just kind of slow down and take a look once you start getting some color on there. Now I'm bringing in the E29, and what I'm doing is I'm kind of just adding little lines underneath the leaves so it looks like they're kind of bending and folding and they have their own shadow. But I'm also taking the very tip of my E29 and I'm running it along the edge of the die cut itself. So there isn't a whole lot actually on top of the die. It's actually in between those cuts. So when I go to finish this, it's actually going to look like that branch has its own dimension, and that's perfect. That's exactly what I want. If you are uncomfortable with this, if you're afraid that you're going to color over something that you don't want to, then absolutely skip this part. You could probably still add the E29. You would just add a very, very fine line along the edge there with the very tip of your marker. Make sure that you're holding it straight up and down, and you can definitely achieve that. But this is not only going to give me my dimension, but it's also serving the purpose of making sure that my edges are covered up. When you're done with this, you could also take a marker, whatever color that you would need. So like the cherries, you could take a red marker and go around the edge of it with the side of your marker if you wanted. But I didn't want to do that. I was comfortable enough in making sure that I wasn't going to color anything that I wasn't intending to. So I did it this way. Okay, so now I have my E25, and from here on out, I'm going to speed this up because this is really easy. I'm just drawing straight lines, just kind of sketching it in a little bit. I'm not doing anything fancy. There's no flicking motions or anything like that, just getting that color on there because I'm going to blend it out, and you're not going to notice too much of the detail anyway. The other thing is, folks, I'm a page turner. I will move my project around however I need it in order to go in the direction that I need to go in. So I need to follow the curve of the branch. So I'm going to turn it slightly diagonally so my hand just naturally flows in the curve of that branch. That is a really good trick. Don't ever feel like you have to work on your piece straight up and down, because you don't. You move it in whatever direction you need to move it to. When I was done with that E25, I went in with the E23. I went back over it one more time with that the E31, and then back in again just to touch it up a little bit with that E23, and I called it good. So now I'm going to start coloring in the breast and the underside of this bird, and I'm going to use the same brown family as I did for the branch. And I'm going to make sure that I really reinforce the highlights and shadows so you can tell those apart. So I started with the E31. I mapped out my shadows. Now I'm in with the E29, which is actually my shadow color, and I'm just going to kind of follow along the neck of this bird. Now, this does make the underside of this bird really dark. I don't think most birds in nature are probably this dark, especially since I think this is supposed to be a robin, but it's my bird. It's my die cut. I'm going to color it any way I would like. So I'm going to make it pretty dark. And also, I really want to show off the difference between the underside of the bird and the branch. I did end up coming in with the E25, then the E23. I thought I was going to add a little bit of shadow to the where it's die cut on the underside of the bird, so it kind of looks like leaves. I decided I didn't like that, so I ended up blending it out with the E31. Again, I'm going to leave that pretty dark. So now I'm going to start coloring in the top half of my bird, as well as his wing and his tail. I am using B21, B23, B26, and B69. The B69 is super duper dark. If you're afraid to go that dark, then you could probably skip that one, because we are working at the top side of the bird. We probably don't need that much a shadow in him. However, I think that the depth of the B69 looks amazing with these other three blue colors. I went over the whole top half of the bird with my lightest color, which was my B21. I made sure that it was good and saturated. Now I'm in with the B26, and I'm starting to map out my shadows. I have those where I want them for the most part. So now I'm in with the B69. I am taking that B69, and I am going over the top of just the top half of the underside of the bird where I had colored that in brown. It's going to make it look kind of gray, but that's fine. It's already pretty dark, so that's just fine. It'll be fine once everything's colored in. So to make him look like he has feathers, because he's a bird and he should have feathers, I'm doing a pretty long flicking motions. It's almost like a streak. So I push down on the tip of my marker a little bit harder where I'm starting once I go down and touch the paper. As I go out in that streaking motion, I lift up, so there's much less pressure on the tip of my marker. So the ends of it look kind of streaky. They look like more like feathers, I guess. So once I get him colored in where I want him to, I'm actually going to bring in the C5. This is a cool gray. It's a relatively dark, cool gray. And I'm going to reinforce some more of those shadows. So I kind of went around his neck a little bit, up underneath his belly, around some of those leaves. I also kind of reinforced those just a tiny bit with the cherries. I really want all of these images to look like they're separate images, although they are part of the same scene. So this cool gray will help do that. I am not using a whole bunch because I don't want to have to blend it back out. It should blend in by itself just fine, but I don't want to have to bring in any of the other colors to blend them back out. I want it to do its job on its own, if that makes any sense at all. So I'm just going around the whole entire die cut where I think that the shadow is still a little too light. I add some of that C5. And again, I still haven't 100% decided where I'm going to place those flowers, so I'm doing everything. At the end of the day, I could have skipped some of it and it would have been just fine. So the Bird on Cherry Branch die set, it actually comes with a separate wing. So I have also cut this out of Nina Solar White cardstock, and now I need to color it in so it matches my bird. And I'm just completely saturating that with the B21, and I made sure that I went around the edges because I don't want any white showing. Now I'm coming directly in with the B69. So there is the holes there where they were die cut, and you're going to be able to see underneath this, the bird underneath it. So for now, I'm just taking that B69, the B26, and I'm just drawing really thin lines on the top edge of those, where those holes are die cut out. And I'll start blending those out with my lighter colors, just like I would any other time. And then I'm going to go over it one more time with the B21 to make sure everything blends in really well. And I'll put it over the top of that, see if I have anything showing that I don't want to show. And I do. I would prefer that it's darker underneath there, so it actually looks like a shadow once that piece is on there. So I just went back in with my B26 on that, and then I'm going to call that good. So these are the little flowers that I die cut out of Nina Solar White cardstock. These come in the die set, and I have cut out 3 sets of them. So there's a total of 6 pieces altogether. I have the Y00. I just completely covered that. And now I'm going to come in with a Y38, and I'm just going to add a little bit of shadow to it. These are itty bitty. They're so tiny. So you do kind of need to be a little careful and make sure that you're not completely covering the whole thing up with the Y38, because otherwise you're going to lose your dimension. Now, that being said, if you really wanted to, you could simply cut these out in yellow cardstock and you could call it a day. You would not need to color them in. I figured since I was already doing all of the coloring, I might as well color them in anyway. Now I'm bringing in the Y15 and I'm going to blend that out a little bit more. I am making sure that I am keeping the tips of each of these pieces really light because I'm going to come back in with the Y00. And I'm going to cover those up. The reason why I'm saying covering those up, because this is what happens. So because Copics, lighter Copics will lift at darker Copics. When you go back over the top of it, all of that alcohol ink completely saturates everything underneath it, and it naturally blends itself out. Sometimes that works out really well. Sometimes you don't want it. In this case, I'm using that to my advantage to make sure that those darker colors blend in nicely with that lightest color. Now I'm doing the bird beak. I use all 3 colors on this little guy's beak, and it's ridiculous because it's so tiny that it's absolutely not necessary, but I thought it added a little bit of extra character. So as soon as I have that done, I'm going to start putting together my flowers. And if you've watched my previous 2 videos, the botanical butterfly, the botanical dragonfly, you'll already be familiar with this. This time I'm going to keep it a little bit easier. I'm just taking my craft pick and I am curling around the edges of those bottom flowers. I'm not worrying about the top pieces of the flowers at all. Those will be just fine just the way they are. I'm also going to do those leaves that I had die cut out and colored the same way. And then I'm going to start putting these guys together. These are really easy. You wouldn't need to do it this way. There is an easier way to do it, but I like all of the extra dimension. So this is how I'm going to do it. I'm taking some dimensional foam tape and I'm just cutting it into smaller pieces. And then I'm going to place the foam tape on top of the bigger flowers. And then once I have those done, I'm going to take the smaller flower and I'm going to simply place it on top. Now, sometimes I'll take a foam pad like the Spellbinders embossing pad, and I'll take a ball stylus like this, and I'll do all the pieces. This time, once I got the three-dimensional foam tape on there, I just went over the top one, and it actually gave it its own dimension. So now I'm going to start attaching some of these flowers. Now this one right here, I'm going to skip because at this point I decided that I was going to put some sort of gloss over the top of them, and I didn't want that flower to interfere with it. The same with these little leaves. I do end up putting a tiny piece of dimensional foam tape back behind that, a little bit of Nuvo adhesive on the bottom of it so everything stays nice and secure, and I attach that. Now this one I'm going to skip for now because, again, I'm going to put some sort of gloss on my panel and I don't want to end up ruining those die cuts. Now I have some dimensional foam tape on that right in the middle of that wing, and then adhesive on the wing, the part of the wing that is closest to his head, because I want it to curve it down. I did end up leaving the back side of that wing sticking out and looking dimensional, which is perfect. Now I have some Nuvo clear glitter gloss. I'm going to go over the cherries as well as the leaves, the highlights on that bird's wing, his tail, his head. I think I might end up putting some on his underbelly, and then I'm going to call it good on that. Now I'm going to take a Uniball Signo white gel pen, and I'm going to add a little bit of highlight to these cherries. I really want to reinforce that light source, and this works really well for that, especially if you put some sort of a gloss over the top of it. When it dries, it almost magnifies that white gel pen, and it makes your image look that much shinier. If you wanted to skip this part, you totally could. I know some folks get really nervous when they start adding pen to their project, especially after all that time of coloring it. You could skip it, but I think it's totally worth it. This is Hero Arts Lacquer, and the reason why I'm going to use this is because it's actually pretty thick. So I have quite a bit of control of where I'm going to put this, and I want to make sure that these cherries continue to look like they're separated. Because this lacquer is so thick and it does not spread out that much once it starts to dry, you can definitely see all of the separate dimension between each one of those cherries, and I love that. I love how that looks. I actually use this lacquer quite a bit. If you don't have this, you could definitely use glossy accents. You could also use Nuvo crystal drops if you would like, but this lacquer is perfect because it is so thick. So I'm just making sure that each one of those is covered up, making sure they're pretty consistent in the cherry shape, because I don't, once it dries, I don't want it to look too funky. Again, it doesn't spread out or dry back that much, so I am trying to pay attention to that. I'm also going to put a little bit on this guy's beak, and then I'm going to call it good for that. I'm going to let that dry. While that's drying, I do want to make sure that this guy's eye is a little bit more visible. There is a little cut there from when I die cut it. So I'm just going to take a black jelly roll pin and add a little bit of black there so you can see his eye that much better. Now I'm going to set that aside so I can wait for that lacquer to finish drying, and I'm going to work on my background. I have a Nina Solar White cardstock that I had initially ink blended Distress Oxide and Peacock Feathers on. I decided that I didn't like that, so now I'm going to do some ink blending with Faded Jeans. The blue-green of the Peacock Feathers would match everything just fine. They are all complementary colors that I used today, but I felt that this darker blue, the Faded Jeans, just work that much better. Now I do have a little bit of a spot here on my panel. I have no idea where that's from, but it's fine because I know that my bird's going to cover it up a little bit. I also know that I want this bird to be a little bit lower down on the panel, more down, lower left, I suppose. So I'm concentrating all of my ink blending on that lower left-hand corner, and I'm just bringing it up lighter and lighter as I go. The Distress Oxide inks are perfect for this because they blend out so well. It's almost effortless. When I start ink blending on the bottom, I go with a heavier hand. And as I move my way up towards the top, I make sure that I let go of some of the pressure on my mini blending tool, so I'm not getting any marks where I don't want them to, and it just naturally fades out. I've also cut down this panel to 4 inches by 5 1/4 because I know that I'm going to be putting something behind it and putting some fun foam behind it to add a little bit more dimension as well. Before I do that, I am actually taking some gold shimmer spritz. Now, I got this a few months ago in a Hero Arts kit, but this stuff is brilliant. It looks white in the bottle. When you splatter it or when you spray it, it actually has a gold tint to it, and it's just beautiful. It also reacts really well to that Distress Oxide ink, and I thought that it would be perfect to help break up some of this background before I add my die cut. I do make sure that I heat set all of that before I start adding anything else to it. Because the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add the sentiment to this. And this is from W+9. This is on a part of the Spring Post stamp set. And I'm going to be using W+9 black ink. This is a really nice, deep, bold, crisp ink. It's always good the first time. And I really want to make this count. I have my bird placed on there. I'm sorry about my head. I have my bird placed on there because I want to give myself an idea where I'm going to stamp the sentiment. I'm going to pull that guy off there, and then I'm going to go straight down with my stamp. You could heat emboss this if you would like. You could use VersaFine Black Onyx inks with some clear embossing powder, and that would look amazing as well, but I didn't feel that it really needed it, and this black ink works great. So now I'm going to pop up my little bird here, and I'm going to use a ton of 3M foam tape. Now, my cherries aren't 100% dry, so I just added a whole bunch to the back of it, being very careful that I wasn't going to touch those cherries. And then I set it off to dry. Once I had it dried on there, I pulled off that backing paper. I placed my die cut on there. Now I just added that last flower and that last leaf. And now I'm going to add a few embellishments to the center of these flowers. I have a Nuvo adhesive, just a dot on each of them. And then I'm using Studio Caudia silver foil crystals to just go on the inside of those flowers. And I'm not going to add any more embellishments to the front of that because I think it's enough. I'm also going to take another piece of Nina Solar White cardstock, and I have this Faded Jeans Distress Oxide ink. I've inked up the Simon's stamp, a diagonal stamp, a background stamp really well with it. Now, it does kind of, the ink does kind of pool a little bit, and I know that that will affect my overall image, but that's fine. It's actually kind of the look that I'm going for. I have a piece of scrap paper pasted over to the top of it because I want to make sure that I'm getting the ink out to the edges. Now, even if it looks a little distress, that's fine. It still needs to go out to the edges because I'm not going to trim down this card panel. I have some fun foam with some double-sided iCraft adhesive on it. I believe this is a 1/2 inch. And I just made sure that I had enough on the fun foam that it's going to stick really well to the back of my panel and make sure that that panel is nice and flat because I did do some heat setting on it earlier and there's just a wee bit of warping. So I want to make sure that I straighten that out. Again, I'm still trying to be kind of careful because I want to make sure that those cherries are good and dry. Now I have some Tombow permanent adhesive on my card panel. This is Nina Solar White cardstock, cut down to 4 1/4 by 11 inches and scored at 5 1/2 inches. And I'm starting at the top fold, and I make sure that the left and the right and the very top edge is straight. Once it is, I can lay that straight down, and it is done. That's it, folks. I don't think that this card needs any more to it. You could definitely add some more sequins or even some more of those silver foil crystals would be pretty cool. But honestly, I would leave it just like this. I really like that this guy just stands out and he is our focal point on our card, which is exactly what we were going for. Really, at the end of the day, folks, if you just take your time and slow down with die cutting, with coloring on die cutting, it is so easy and it's so much fun. I just really enjoy how it turned out. I sure hope you enjoyed my card today. If you did, be sure to hit that like button and share it with your friends. Thanks again so much for stopping by. Until next time.